Right. Alright, I'm probably gonna end up repeating this a few times, but welcome back. It's been a little while. For the past couple weeks, I've been working on stroke stuff, or just lots of little things, but I'll just quickly run through it. So, first change is the size slider is now exponential, because it was pretty difficult to pick smaller sizes with the regular size slider. So now when you're on the smaller sizes, it's gonna cover more distance, which you can kind of see here. So going from 1 to 2 is a pretty big chunk. 2 to 3 is half of that. 3 to 4 is half of that. And it keeps going like that. So it's a little bit easier to control smaller sizes. And then the kind of the more technical thing that's been changed is mouse press and release events. So when you put down the pen and when you release the pen, before the pressure would be zero always. It would just always default to zero, which would result in these little like pointy ends on every stroke. So now I've added pressure to the mouse buttons, which was a huge pain because that had to be done in the engine side. So I had to learn a little bit of C++ and just figure out how to communicate with Windows, Mac, Linux, Android, and iOS, finally, with all of their different pen and mouse APIs, and figure out how to get pressure into the mouse button events, which the mouse motion events, which is, you know, anytime you're moving, has pressure on all of those now, but mouse button did not. So now we have it, which is kind of a tiny, it's a kind of a tiny thing, but I think it's pretty nice. Just because you can start your strokes and they don't always have the little tiny point to them. If you start off with a lot of pressure, and I don't know, it just feels a little bit more responsive. Hello, Vladimir. So those are two big changes. That mouse button thing probably took up the most amount of time. I literally just finished figuring it out like a few hours ago, and that was my past 2 weeks. So it's very slow because I don't know C++ yet, so I'm kind of just bumbling around and just figured out how to do really basic stuff there. And just what everything means. It's very confusing to me right now. But I'm glad I'm learning it, at least, or digging into it a little bit, because I can see how in the future that's going to come in handy, just adding, you know, more engine-related features. Okay, so the other thing that's been improved is the autosave logic has become a lot more practical, I think, because before it was a little bit brute force, where it would just save every 20 strokes or so. It would just run an autosave no matter what, as soon as your 20th stroke finished, which was, it worked okay, but I think it was bad because sometimes if you are doing lots and lots of little strokes in succession, sometimes the autosave would actually interrupt your next stroke if it happens right after completing the last stroke. So I've changed it now to work on a timer. So when you finish a stroke, every time you finish a stroke, it kicks off a timer. And when that timer runs out, it checks if it's supposed to be doing an autosave or not. And then it'll run the autosave if it should be doing an autosave. And what that does is it makes it so that the autosave only happens after a set delay, after the stroke is done, so it's not going to happen right in the middle of you doing lots of quick little hatch marks like this. It'll never happen now, like during this, which is good, because we don't want to have interruptions there. It's much more likely to happen now when you're, let's say you finish your stroke and you go to a menu, and now the timer has run for like three seconds or so while you're in the menu, and then it's going to save, which I think is a lot better time to save when you're inside the menu versus while you're in the middle of hatching something furiously, right? So it's the same autosave, it's just been moved to a safer spot to do it where it's not going to interrupt your sketching. Hey Allison. Oh man, iPad mini. You got the pencil for it too? I've been curious about the iPad minis. They look really it's a really nice size actually, because like my tablet that I love is about the same size as the iPad mini, and yeah, I wonder if it's more comfortable to use than the iPad Pro. And I'm curious about the performance too. Oh, thanks, Camden. Do you ever think about adding a little Easter eggs? Like a song? What would the song be? That would be cool. Although songs, music does take up a lot of space. And fuck. Oh my god. My monitor just fell. That's what I get for not mounting it properly. It's just like sitting on my desk. Well, I mean, there are little tiny things, I guess, like hardcore mode, and I mean, there's plenty of settings that people probably never use, but yeah, it would be cool to have little silly things in there that are just little surprises, I guess. Little messages or something. I'll think about where that could be cool. The draw sound. Oh yeah, I need to add the draw sound back in. I think it's been taken out, but anyway. Okay, so this picture probably will be a challenge for me because I'm not used to doing these super high key things. Or I guess this isn't super high key, but let's see. This was the other day. I was walking down by the river and I saw this. I usually go there just to look at the birds. There's some cranes and ducks and whatever that live at the river. And then this guy was taking photos, so I took a picture of him. And he had the kind of the massive lens, you know, the one that looks like a bazooka, sort of. Is that bright enough? Yeah, I'm not used to judging these kind of colors that come through with lens effects and stuff. So I imagine I'll probably have to go back in a few times to get this. Oh, and I forgot to mention the other thing that's been, the other big development is that all the draw type tools now have this option called rounded ends, which maybe I need to come up with a better name for that. But this, for anybody who's used the really old versions of Heavy Paint, is like the oil tool in old Heavy Paint, where the ends of the stroke get this rounded pattern to them. Let me show it with a sort of like this. So it looks a little bit, I guess, more smooth or round. But I had to use a whole different sort of method to get these rounded edges, which it has a couple trade-offs actually, which I'm not totally happy with. Like when you use this rounded edge, it looks really cool, but then you get sort of, I don't know if you can see, but there's a little bit of, jitter on the colors, and also there's some jitter on the size sometimes. You can see the size is jumping around a little bit, which is not great. It's actually, it looks worse on iOS, so eh. I mean, for now, I think I'm just gonna put it in because it's sort of a interesting option that I think some people might like, but it is an option now, so you can always turn it off and just go back to regular, like how it is right in the previous versions. So I mean, ideally I want to go back in and make it so that these regular strokes can have rounded edges. By I just need to come up with a way to detect when there's like a big break in the angle of 2 points, and subdivide it whenever you see like a chunky angle. So that's gonna take some work. I probably want to do that in C++ actually, because C++ is way faster than GDScript, which is like the regular programming stuff. So maybe all this digging into C++ is actually going to be helpful in the end, eventually. And I'm sorry that I'm getting kind of nerdy with you guys here. I know not everybody is really interested in the programming side of stuff, but whatever. We're on the Heavy Poly channel, and there's no one else that I can talk to this stuff about, so I'm sorry, guys. You have to listen to me talk about nerdy programming stuff. But yeah, if anybody in here, if you guys know C++, I'm jealous. It seems like an alien language to me right now, and I'm struggling really hard because it looks so confusing. And it's so different from what I'm used to. And every little thing is like taking more and more time to research. But I don't know, I always get myself into these kind of research holes, and I think I secretly enjoy it. So there's that. I enjoy the process. Oh yeah, other things that have changed in this version is somebody on the Discord was saying that when they have the colors or the control panel down here, they want to be able to draw through it. So that's been done now. Before, you could draw through parts of it, but other parts would sort of like block the drawing input. So now it's all been fixed so that you can completely draw through the whole entire controls. And then that also works if you're in, you know, vertical mode. You can draw through the bars and everything. So that's a nice change. I don't think anyone will complain about that. And then another change is, this is a suggestion from Devin Corwin. He wanted the border here to be adjustable. So let me see what this, actually, why isn't this working? So yeah, it controls the border of the standard border that happens around the canvas. And this, you know, normally you'd be like, oh well, I can just zoom in and out, right? But this is more for if you are trying to, let's say, create a new page, and let's say you like to have very small borders or no border at all, then, and it takes the shortest side, so it's taking this bottom side right now. Let me make this like this so you can see. Yeah, so you can make the border 0. And if you make a new page, it should retain that border. Because he was having an issue where he would have to like zoom in and out every time he made a new page to the preferred border size that he wanted. So this is for Devin. And what else? I'm sure there's other things too I'm forgetting. But yeah, I'm pretty excited about this one because the drawing performance should be better with that autosave change and the stroke changes, I think. This whole adventure was kicked off when I was painting, or I was watching somebody new using heavy paint, and they were like struggling with the drawing aspect of it, and they're like, oh, why do the strokes, sometimes they skip strokes and sometimes the strokes don't come out like they're ugly and blah blah blah. And I was like, you know what, this has been a complaint for a while, I need to spend some quality time, just get into it and try to improve it a little bit. Like, it's still not perfect, but I hope that it's better. It feels a little more responsive. Hello, Roomboo. I'm messing around with my wife's iPad Pro. Yeah, I also think the iPad Pro sometimes is too big. Like, especially if you're just using it outside and trying to hold it in your lap or whatever, it's too cumbersome, I think. So, I actually prefer using my little cell phone with the pencil to draw with, because it's more, you know, it's handheld. So yeah, smaller devices can be really nice for, especially when you're outside. I saw this guy at a paint session the other day. He had a sunshade for his iPad. It was like specially designed for iPad mini, actually, and it was like three-sided and it perfectly fits the screen, and it covers really nice. It looks super pro. I need to make one for my phone. I think one of the guys in the Discord, Michael, also made a little video where he made one out of cardboard. It's pretty cool. I tried to make one too. I'll try fill stretch for the trees just because it's more. I should have used fill stretch in the beginning. Or, actually, to me, the trees actually look like a line radial, like this. That's what I should have used. Let me go back. Wrong tool. That looks better, I think. It looks like it has little ripples in it already. Which, if I can save any work, if you know me, I'm kind of a lazy person. I'm into seeing how little I can get away with. Or how minimal we can be, I guess, or how efficient we can be. That sounds better. Efficient. That's a better word than lazy. Okay, it's definitely not that dark, right? Like, I feel like it should be dark because that's what I'm used to painting, but since there's all this glare happening, it should be a lot lighter. And then when we go away from the glare, it gets darker. So the glare is all happening like over on this side. So as we go to the left, I'll slowly creep the colors down. And try to make the trees as simple as I can, so I don't get too busy with them. Hello, Kate. Lane draws have a custom iPad holder. Oh, is he a YouTuber or somebody? That's cool. I always like when people make their own custom tools for their either for painting or for drawing or whatever. That's always, I don't know. I think artists and myself included are really, we like tools because we spend all of our waking hours using tools. So I think we're all like naturally gonna be sort of tool nerds, and we like to see our each other's setups and compare notes and see who has the coolest setup, right? So I love that kind of stuff. Spent ages when I was doing a lot of planar painting. I was like really racking my brain on how to make, a good portable gouache setup, but I kind of gave up because all the paints kept leaking out or drying out or whatever, just not working how I expected them to. I think you would need better tools to do it properly, like a shop. A wood shop or something to make an actual good setup for gouache. But that's why I like this digital stuff, is because all I need is my little laptop. Don't need any messy tools, don't need a workshop, don't need anything. This is the only tool that I need, and it works really good, really portable. But I've caught myself before. Sometimes I'll be like looking at, Unreal Engine or Blender or some tech or some tool, and I'm almost more fascinated with the tool than the art sometimes, which is kind of backwards. But I think I'm more on the engineering side of, like, I have that part of me that I. I need to pay attention to, I guess. I think my issue is I'm a very bad storyteller. When I start telling a story, people usually just, their eyes will gloss over and they'll fall asleep or whatever. So I've just never been a great storyteller. And I feel like to be an artist, you sort of need to have that in you too. You gotta be able to like tell stories and believe in your stories, I guess, that your stories are interesting at least. And I don't know. I don't have that kind of confidence in my stories. I just want to make something that will let other people tell their stories. Wow, this is so orange here. That's awesome. Okay. So this little orange highlight should be pretty much directly underneath the light up here. You know what? I'm gonna add the cursor back because I can't see what I'm doing. I'm gonna go to cursor, change it to arrow. Okay. Let me save this. I turned it off because I was using the Huion screen tablet and it's easier to use it. Or it's nicer to use it without the stupid arrow in the way, but since I'm using this little tablet, might as well go back to the arrow so I can see what's going on. Can I paint a yacht? I probably could. It's an interesting question. Why are you? Are you painting a yacht? Try to go crazy with the actually not that crazy. I do want some color vibration up here in the highlight, so I'm just cranking it up slightly so that we get some crazy rainbow party happening up there. Which for a painter, I guess that's like the closest thing we can do to having a high dynamic range screen, because you know when you're painting you don't have that range of colors, so if you want to go super bright, a lot of painters will just start vibrating the colors so it looks like it's almost like your paints are glitching out because it's so strong. The camera, the paints can't handle the intensity, so they just vibrate out of control. I guess that's how I think of it. I think it's darker than what I first thought. Modeling a yacht. Oh, that's cool. I had to model a yacht in school. It was a pretty fun project. I asked you one day how to get better geometry in Modo. You said perhaps you go for CAD. So now I'm learning SolidWorks. Oh, nice. Yeah, some shapes are just really difficult to do in polygon modelers, so sometimes you just got no choice. You just gotta do CAD. Hello, Frank Draws Near. Welcome. All right, back here is way darker than I thought it was. It's more like that, right? Which is a bit of a shame because I'm going to lose a lot of this texture on the trees. That kind of stinks. But that looks more like it, right? There should probably be a bit of a gradient on this too. Oh, another change. I mean, actually, I don't know if I did this in the last version or not, but now heavy paint is going to start with no layers. So if you start up a fresh heavy paint, you're not going to see the layers interface, and you're not going to see eraser or the stencil tool, which are two of the layers type tools, which I think I think it'll make it more fun for new people and maybe less overwhelming because there'll be less buttons and like you won't have that layers thing in the way. So, I mean, I've been really enjoying painting without layers again just to play, you know, test around, and I don't miss layers at all. I think maybe layers, I will use it if I have to, you know, if it's required for work or whatever, but just for me painting myself, I it's more fun without it, honestly. Spent like entire 2020 working on layers, and now I've decided I'm over it. I don't want layers anymore. I mean, it's still gonna be there, but it's not, it's gonna be a little bit hidden, so it's not forced on the new user right away. And yeah, it, I mean, that's one of the things that people liked about heavy paint in the beginning anyway, is just that there was no layers, there was no pressure, there was basically nothing. So and people actually liked that, which is something that I sort of I guess lost a little bit in the later version. So I'm trying to slowly hone in on what's the right balance of things. I think maybe I went a little bit too far with the layers versions, and it got too complicated too fast. So now I'm trying to see what I can take out and have it still work or have it still be fun to use, because that's the most important thing, I think, is like somebody has to pick up the program, start playing with it, and just have a good time. Sort of the goal is for them to get lost in it and just sort of even forget that they're using a program and just feel like they're just painting. And it's a difficult thing to do. You kind of gotta present some tools and then just step back and get out of the way. But it's difficult. And the other question too is, do you want to try to show off all the things that are unique to heavy paint, or do you want to, on the other side of the spectrum is, if you do too many things that are new and different, it might scare people off too and just be like, oh, what is this? I don't, this isn't comfortable, this isn't familiar. Close. Close the program, never open it again. So that's the other side of the coin. So I'm trying to find a balance between those two things of like, have some things that are familiar, some things that are new, but overall it should feel fresh and it should feel good, I guess. How is Mr. Streamer today? I'm doing okay. I'm kind of relieved today because I finally finished working on this thing that was really frustrating for the past few weeks. So I'm just celebrating a little bit with a mini stream. Does something doable is necessarily a good thing to add? Right. I guess just because we can doesn't mean we should. Not always, right? Especially now because we can do so many things with technology and stuff, right? We basically have unlimited. We can do unlimited things. We just have to now decide what we want to do and what we don't want to do, which is a good problem to have. But yeah, for my purposes, the drawing performance is a lot better with this version. Like, I haven't noticed any lag or any pauses or anything. Now, I won't say for sure that it's going to be the same for everyone because I know that whenever I put out an update and I've done a lot of testing on it, there's just certain things that everybody does paints differently, so the way that I paint isn't really representative of all, everyone. So I'm sure other people will have different, maybe they paint like super fast and they'll make the system explode or something. There's always something that I didn't really account for. So I'll just put it out and pray that it works. It's the only way. Just gotta go for it. This is too bright in general. I'm gonna do something blasphemous here and just turn on opacity. Oh God, that looks horrible. See, opacity. Oh, that's not too bad. That's not too bad. I feel dirty now, though, after doing that. I need to go take a shower. That's another thing that a lot of people have requested is like, you know, adjustment layers and curves and being able to shift the hue on your layers and stuff like that, which is really, really simple to do. Like, it can be, it could be done in a day, but that's one of those things that I'm still holding out on, as just because we can doesn't mean we should. Because I feel like that does take out a lot of the fun of painting, when you can just squiggle around the colors whenever you want. It's like there's no permanence to it, and there's no stakes, because you can just change it all afterwards. So I like the just the yeah it's more intense when you paint, and you know that, you know, what you see is what you get. I mean, just the fact that we have undo here makes it so that I paint completely differently. If I was going to paint with real paint, I would be so much more careful and slow. But here, I'm just painting like an idiot because I have my undo tool. So, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Like, opacity in heavy paint is one of those things that's only supposed to be used, like, in an emergency, as a last resort, and you're not supposed to feel good about using it, so that's why it's hidden all the way down in the bottom, and you have to, like, go through a menu to get to it. Whereas something like color jitter, this is something that you should feel good using, so it's put up in the front. And it's you know, easily accessible. So that's kind of how I order things in the program, is like things that are more fun to paint with should be more available to you, and things that make painting not as fun should be hidden. Maybe that's too much. Oh, another change for this version too is the circles tool. I don't know if anybody has actually used the circles tool, but just from looking at paintings online on Instagram and whatever, I noticed that most people don't use circles tool, so I've just renamed it to hard round, which is the same thing as circles tool, but this is like the Photoshop-ish name, or this is what a lot of programs call this type of tool. So I've just renamed it so it's going to match up with what people expect, I guess. So, I don't know. I don't know if people will use it more because of that or not, but I think probably a lot of people think that heavy paint doesn't even have this kind of tool because it's sort of named something different. So I'm just trying to make it more discoverable. Super windy. We're just slowly creeping the colors toward the right. Oh, one other thing that's changed is Smudge has become, the noise size has been, the limit has been increased so that you can go really high on the noise, like the fineness of the noise, so it kind of looks more, almost more like a blur. So to the point where you can't really see the noise that much anymore. And there's the blur setting now, which has been in the last version too, but I'll just show you guys right now what it looks like. Oh wait, there's something messed up here. Why is the noise, why is the size not? Something wrong here. The size needs to go way bigger. Something's wrong with my max size here. Okay, I need to fix that before we release. And then, oh yeah. So the other thing I wanted to show is that there's this new texture jitter setting, which this is the regular texture right here. Let's go to 100% stretch. Okay, here's the standard texture. Then when we start adding texture jitter and the amount, it controls how strong the jitter is, and the texture jitter controls how the size of the noise. So this just gives an extra, I guess, layer of noise to the texture if you need it. So, and you can see in real time what it does on the tool setting panel. You can just play around with all those. So with just one texture, you can make a lot of different effects, I guess, is the point. You know, and that'll probably save some memory and just have more fun with your existing textures. Another thing I've been wanting to experiment with is on mobile devices with cameras, or even a computer with a webcam, is to have the ability to take pictures and use those as textures or tool textures. I think that would be pretty cool. So if you're just walking down the street and you see a cool, like, manhole cover or something you want to use as a stamp, you just take a photo and it imports it automatically, and you can just start painting with it. Jay Leo, your Gumroad gave an error. Could you maybe email Gumroad support about that, because when there's a Gumroad error, I can't really do anything about it. So just send them your receipt, and hopefully they can help you with it. Because Gumroad generates the license key and everything, so I, yeah, we need to do that through Gumroad. Is there any other things in the program where you can talk to the reason behind why you made it that way? I mean, everything in the program is made for painting, obviously, because it's called heavy paint. And the way you can think about it is like, I don't know, just trying to remove as many clicks, as remove as many steps as possible, remove clicks. Make things that make the artist add things that make the l artist's life easier. Like, one thing is the borders. This is one of the first little weird ideas that I had, is to have, you know, when you start a new painting, you have a border automatically, and you can paint from outside the border into the painting, which is something that, so I mean, a lot of programs work like this, but this is something I definitely wanted, because when you're painting in real life, sometimes you want to paint from the corner inwards. You don't always want to be up to the edge of the, like, I don't like when the painting goes all the way up to the edge of the screen, because you're trying to get your pencil in the edge and it's like hitting up against the edge of the screen. So I made that smaller, made the interface kind of dark or mid-tone so that you can compare colors. I made the base canvas color gray, because I feel like a white canvas is way, it's too bright. It like hurts my eyes. So I like having a toned kind of a gray canvas to start with. For example, eyedropper tool. It works by just hovering. When you're hovering over, it's picking. And then when you put down your pen, it picks that color. And then it also goes back to your previous tool. So that's like three things in one. Right there, because I know in Photoshop, if you want to do eyedrop, or if you were going to click on the eyedrop tool, you would have to click on the eyedrop tool, pick the color, and then click back onto your old tool. Whereas here, it knows that once you pick a color, you want to go back to your old tool. So let's just automatically put you back on your old tool. So it's lots of little things like that, where things that I know when you're doing a painting, like, this is the process, this is the workflow. So let's just automatically do some of those things so you don't have to repeat yourself or click the same button 5 billion times. And this is nothing against Photoshop, because Photoshop is different. It's a different tool for a different purpose. It's not made for painting. It's made for photo manipulation. So, of course, the tools are going to work differently. So all these tools here are just made for painting, basically. What else? I don't know. There's gazillions of little things that I. Oh yeah, having the color sliders here exposed in the front, taking up a lot of space. That's something where, if you're painting with real paint, your palette's probably going to be as big as your painting, or maybe even bigger sometimes, especially if you're working on like a tiny gouache painting. Your palette might be like 2 or 3 times bigger than the painting itself. So I think it's good to have a lot of space for your tools, for your colors, just because, like, you need the space for the control over the colors. You know, you need fine control. If this is too tiny, it's not going to be good for your control. Color jitter, that's another one. Like, I don't know of any other apps that have color jitter in the front, because it's usually seen as sort of a secondary setting, but I believe it's a first class setting, and it gives a lot of life to your paintings if you have some color jitter. So I decided to put it in the front. And I believe that painters probably want color jitter to be in the front too, not just me. Thanks, Kate. Yeah, that means a lot, 'cause yeah, this is like my I spent so much time on it, put so much, sweat and effort into it. So I'm really glad that you guys appreciate it and like using it. And I feel like this is a project that, is not even something I started working on it maybe 3 years or so years ago, but honestly, the process is much longer than that because I've spent my whole life using painting programs, like all of them, right? And I know all the painting programs, I know how they work, and I know how I work, and I've always had ideas of like little things that I want to have in a painting program. So now I finally have a chance to put it all together. And yeah, the coolest part about it all is like originally I just started the thing as a little weekend project just so I could use it on my phone, but then people on Instagram and stuff were like, "Hey, I want to use it. Let me try it out." And then it kind of just had a little life of its own from there. And now it's like taken over my life, sort of. And I really, yeah, the coolest part is just seeing what you guys are doing with it. And getting to talk to you about it and just nerd out about tools and UI and all this stuff that I'm interested in. And too bright. Too bright, too bright, too bright. Smudge defaults settings have been adjusted a little bit to be a tiny bit smoother. So I think it's a little more practical this way. I've been playing around with it on some meat paintings and it's been fun. Okay, what's going on this top left side? It's this color, like maybe up here in the middle of that section, but then on the bottom left corner of it, there's a gradient where it's like darker, right? a little bit orangey, darker. Maybe I can use fill gradient. More orange. Yeah. There it is. And then on the right side, it's pinkish, which I think I have here, but it's not strong enough. Muhammad says, "It's first week using an iPad. I feel like I'm gonna have a heart attack working without a keyboard." Yeah. Yeah, it's weird without a keyboard, right? You have this instinct, like your fingers just have to be pressing buttons all the time. But yeah. I know what you're talking about. I was really, really into hotkeys on Photoshop too. I knew every single hotkey, all the like secret ones, and I was like, yeah, I'm so fast, look at me go. But yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. You just have an urge to press buttons. I actually like working without too much keyboard now. Because it feels more like actual painting when you're just, it's just you and the pen or the pencil. Sorry guys, I've had too much of this song lately. Hey Benjamin. How's it going? Any plan to make a sketchbook gallery someday? Yeah. That has been a request since the early days, so I need to do that eventually. Please make the photo thing. I want to introduce your app to my students, but I want to try it out first. Oh, cool. Yeah, that would be great. There's been starting to be a few painting classes that are using heavy paint, which I'm really excited about. Because, yeah, I wish I had a tool like this when I was learning, because I think I would have learned a lot faster. It needs some darkening. Yeah, maybe. Yeah, the middle definitely is darker in the photo. Let's see. Should put this guy in here too. Oh yeah, Ringling. Ilya was using it. One of the teachers at Ringling. It's pretty awesome. For figure drawing. And then Henry Chow is using it for a class at Warrior Art Camp. It's pretty cool. Okay, this highlight's looking wackadoo. Yeah, it definitely is darker. Gonna have to dig into the whatchamacallit, opacity again. Bring out the blur. Actually pretty sharp over there. Right? Do I want to put this guy in here? Probably should. Cool. Good to have characters, right? Bye, Kate. Is there a function in Heavy Paint where you can make a video of how the painting came together? Yeah, yeah, if you click on this book thing, then go back one page and then go back forward, and this will replay the whole painting. But you do have to record it with like screen recorder or whatever. But it's pretty easy because at least iPad and Android have screen recorders as part of the OS, I think. So you can just do it like that, or you can use OBS if you're on desktop. Oof, I want to add like a GIF export at some point. I think that would be cool. Although the GIFs would be huge. Maybe it would be like every 10 strokes or something like that. Why GIF? Because that's the only option that I have for this engine that I'm using. And they've just added that, so this is like cutting edge for the engine I'm using. And I like, I have a soft spot for GIF because it just, I don't know. It's nice that it just automatically plays. You don't need a video player for it. Oh, Instagram doesn't support GIF? No, that's a bummer. Oh, Frank is saying bye. Sorry, Frank, bye. I think I missed him. How much do copy the reference versus pushing the painting in the direction you like? That's up to the artist, you know? Like, totally up to you. I know I tend to be on the less... I probably stay closer to the photo than I should. I'm trying to work on getting farther away from it, actually, but yeah. Okay, I'm gonna save this one as a copy just before I add the guy because I'm scared that I'm gonna screw it up. LA River Bird Watcher. It's not, I think it's nice without the bird watcher, but I should probably add the bird watcher in if the painting's called bird watcher. Thank you. Oops. Crank the opacity back. I should probably be putting him on a different layer. That would be the smart thing to do. But I am feeling dumb today, so I'm just gonna... Even though I know that the lens was pure white, this giant lens, we still gotta make it orange because everything in here is like base orange, right? Or the white. White in this lighting is orange, so let's just make everything orange. And then this is the highlight off the barrel. Okay, one thing that I didn't notice before, but now I see, is that the head... Okay, it has a halo around it, but also it feels a little bit darker than the background around it. And wow, this is actually way different than what I have in the middle here. Oh shoot, I screwed up in the middle, especially. Yeah, everything in the middle here needs to be pretty bright. Like this. Yeah, this is one of those big late adjustments where I'm probably gonna end up ruining the painting because it's too late to be making this kind of a big adjustment here. But I'll try. Yeah, I was way off on the color, the brightness in particular. Maybe I can be lazy a little bit and smudge my way out of this. Famous last words. Maybe I can smudge my way out of this. Damn. Ooh, what am I doing? Oh no, this looks horrible. Okay, I'm gonna cave and make a lair because I'm just. I'm shook, as the kids would say. Just gonna use this as a mask. Oh my God. This looks like ass. So I'm hoping if we just paint in colors manually here that it'll look okay. Okay. There's hope. There's still hope. Save it. Brighter orange. I like this weird rainbow thing going on. It's like greenish. green again. Then it's red. I'm okay with this. Like, normally I would just skip this type of thing because I'm really not comfortable with it, and it's a little bit scary, but since we're here on stream and I want to appear to be brave in front of the internet, I'm just gonna go for it and see what happens. It's like an experiment, I guess. If and hopefully, even if this one goes kind of bad, at least the next time I try this, attempt this kind of a thing again, it'll be a little less freaky, you know? So yeah, I'm not sure. It looks weird for sure. Maybe I need a blur. Yeah, blur the edges a little bit. Switch layers there to get back onto the god rays. I guess I could. Oh, I'm feeling extra naughty, so I'm gonna turn on layers and turn on the opacity, and that's a little better too. Oh, it needs more blur. That's how you know when you don't like the painting and you're just keep blurring it and blurring it, smudging it until you can't even see the thing anymore. Then it's like, okay, mission accomplished. We've hidden the horrors of this painting. I think the background is not helping either. Like, this smudgy here is not right, because this should be like buttery smooth. This should be like, yeah, that should be like that. That makes a lot more sense. Okay, that makes more sense. This is less scary now. Maybe I should just go full rainbow. No, that doesn't work. Does it? Maybe it does. Oh god, did it freeze? My first crash, guys. Or not. What? Okay. Huh. That was. I think it got stuck in a menu, a pop-up menu or something. For a sec there. Okay, well, not a crash. Just need to figure out what menu caused that. Do you ever stylize because you're too lazy to get it right? Yes, all the time. Stylizing is a great way to be lazy with style, right? I mean, that's the best case scenario. If you can be lazy while convincing people that you're actually, I don't know, doing something extra, you know? I'm pretty happy with how hot the highlight's looking. I think that's pretty nice. Yeah, okay. Some of this. Oh shit. I need to figure out how to fix that. Oh, fuck. Yeah, that's weird. No. God damn it. It's some kind of bug where, like, I think it's if I release the mouse outside of the heavy paint window, then it doesn't actually release the mouse, so it gets stuck in like non-release mode. I need to figure that out. What the hell? Finally. Surprised the stream hasn't gotten taken off the air yet because of the music. Probably will in a minute. Usually happens at some point. But I'm too stubborn to not play music. This is weird. I haven't seen this one yet. It's like, the input was blocked for a minute. The ugly rainbow from PS. What is that? Like a gradient? The gradient texture? That's a pretty good texture. That's a classic. I've definitely used that rainbow thing. Well, I've used the chrome gradient texture in Photoshop. I've definitely used that one. And the grass brush and all the other tools. The classics. Not sure if you can really tell what this guy's doing with the camera, but it's okay. I like how his foot sort of melts into the floor. Alright. I'm too lazy to do the sparkle on the ground. But maybe I can get a little bit of this action happening. Vibration. Yeah, like we were saying before, I think you can turn down the vibration or the color vibration as we go farther away to make it look less intense, or like there's less energy there. Hopefully that'll come across. looking very, very crunchy. Which I love crunchy paintings. So I'm pretty happy. The crunch here. Should probably soften this up a little. Using the airbrush sparingly. I should zoom out. This is getting too ridiculous. Too close. I don't like how this figure turned out. Let me see if I can cheat a little. Liquify, where's Liquify? Too bad I didn't put it on another layer, huh? I guess that's what I get for trying to be cool. Yeah, I need to calm down on this figure here. Okay, last thing, maybe a tiny bit of these little sticks here and there. Sticks are always cool. Sticks make everything better. Grabbing the color from the concrete. Especially little dark sticks are cool too, but not too dark. It's gotta be the right value. Even though it's just a stick, you still have to pay attention to it. Like how this stick just disappears up top. So maybe we can try to do that. Also disappears down here. Just painting in a value. We're gonna airbrush a little bit to try to make it grainy. Oh shit. Nope. That's not what I wanted. Oh, there we go. What? Oh, so I have to resize. I see. The reason why the size wasn't working proper, the max size wasn't what it should be, is because I need to resize the window? What? Yeah, okay. Resizing the window fixed it, but That's a bug. It should just do that automatically. Okay, we got the green there. Maybe a little bit of orange. I'll put it on another layer. Orange green there. That actually looks cool. I'm into that. Yeah, okay. Airbrush to the rescue. That, I think that helped everything out. Just to melt together. Green is always cool. Who doesn't like green, right? Okay. I'll keep it semi-subtle. Alright guys, it has been 2 freaking hours. Wow, that went really fast. But I really enjoyed this painting. I hope you guys had fun hanging out for a little bit. I'm gonna fix up these little tiny loose ends here. What do we have? The size needs to update properly, or the max size needs to update properly, and there was one other thing. What was it? It's gonna kill me. Maybe it'll come back to me when I'm about to fall asleep or something. It'll come to me. I just wanted to soften up some of these. Get more of that orange in. Make it more festive. But yeah, this version should be wrapped up pretty soon. Excited to get it out. I think it's gonna be just more pleasant in general to use. Thanks, Alex. Hey, Shinyu. Thank you. Bringing back gerbil ships. Oh man, I would love to. I'm thinking about doing some more spaceship stuff soon. I've ordered a new laptop when that comes in, I want to play with it and try to do some Blender and 3D stuff. So maybe we'll do some stream later on. Hey, White Tiger. Yeah. Are we ever going to be able to set hue and value to speed distance again? Oh, shoot. Oh, yeah, that's definitely doable. I can add that back in. Okay, let me write down a few of the notes from today just so I don't forget, because I have horrible memory. Here, I'll write that down. Hue value to speed distance. And probably pressure while we're at it, right? And then size, brush size, max slider, not updating. And then there was one more thing. What am I forgetting? Oh yeah, button released outside of window. Makes it glitch. Oh my god, what was the last thing? I know I'm forgetting something. God damn it. Now I'm seeing this painting and I want to change it some more. This is dangerous. A little bit of extra detail in the front couldn't hurt. Yeah, of course, Benjamin. I mean, I don't listen to every suggestion, but if it's a good one, I'll put it in. So, but yeah, thank you for reminding me to do that. I need to do that eventually. Okay, guys, I'll sign off now. Hope you have a good Thanksgiving if you're over here in the USA. If not, then have a good Thursday tomorrow. I'll see you next time.